Thank you for waiting. It gives me great pleasure to welcome the First Minister back to Traquair for what I think is an extremely important session about women in politics and peacemaking. It was this time last year that the First Minister first came to Traquair and we discussed the idea of a potential fellowship program for women peacemakers around the world. And I'm pleased to say that Nicola heard the message and has now promoted Scotland's first 1325 fellowship program. And we have with us today female peacemakers from Lebanon, from Turkey, from Iraq, from Syria, from Libya. I think some of you heard them yesterday. So just my heartfelt thanks to everything that Nicola has done and also the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament for Beyond Borders, with the assistance of the United Nations to develop this programme. Unfortunately, Staffan de Mistura cannot be with us today. Everyone knows the situation in Aleppo. There is also a developing situation on the eastern outskirts of Damascus. Fears of another Srebrenica, and of course, Kerry and Lavrov are still talking in Geneva. But he will call through. Unhappily, my boss doesn't do FaceTime. I work for Staffan de Mistura. He doesn't do FaceTime. He doesn't do Skype. He will call on his less than smartphone. So do bear with us. We're going to actually literally just put a microphone to the phone. So it may not be the best production values, but I think actually it's indicative of the time. So, Louise, if I can just hand over to you for introductions, and then if we can phone Stefan in a minute.
Okay. Well, as they say in the Middle East, only God is perfect. So we're not hoping for perfection today, and it is completely in tune with our session today about getting more women involved in politics and peacemaking, that women, I'd like to think, have a real can-do spirit. Don't you think so? So I think this is a very good way to start. It's not going to be perfect, but it's actually going to be ideal for what we need. My name is Lyse Doucet. I am here today because I am a journalist for the BBC who does a lot of reporting on Syria. I'm here today because I'm very much part of Beyond Borders. Being Canadian, I think I'm about 30% Scottish, waiting for the DNA test, but they said, okay, fine, good enough, 30%, we'll take it. We need all the Scots we need in Scotland. And thirdly, I'm here because I am like all of you. I'm concerned and worried about the situation in Syria, and I also believe that there should be more women involved in leadership roles in politics and also peacemaking. So we'd like to know before we start, how many of you are here because you agree with those two principles too? Put up your hands. And honestly now, how many of you are here because you want to see the First Minister? Okay. As we say about women, we can have it all. We can have it all. First Minister Sturgeon, I think it's very impressive that with your very, very busy schedule, you have decided to put Syria, the challenges of Syria, but also the challenges of getting women into politics and peacemaking. You launched here last year, if those of you were here, a new initiative at Beyond Borders, a Women in Conflict Peace Initiative, and the 1325 Fellowship Program is beginning. And I'd like the women in the 1325 Fellowship Program to put up your hands. Alan Wasalan, welcome. And I think we should all welcome them here to Scotland. And with us as well is a friend of mine, a friend of Mark's, and a friend of peacemaking, Teresa Whitfield, who's had a long experience, a thinker, a doer, and writer on peacemaking, on mediation, who is now an advisor on politics and mediation in the Department of Political Affairs at the United Nations. Teresa, thank you very much. And we are also going to have Staffan de Mistura, who will join us shortly by telephone. Is he there now?
Staffan, you're there still?
Yes. Tell him I'm introduced. I have a very important news today, and I want to be very humble, but I've been appointed just yesterday a UN Goodwill Ambassador. I know this is very good. But it's very specific. My only job was to convey for Staffan that, because I was in Geneva yesterday, he is very, very sorry he couldn't be with you today. And now my job as Goodwill Ambassador is over.
Yeah. Okay. Speak to Staffan. I think we'll put him.
Hello, Staffan? Okay, we'll have a microphone. I've just conveyed your regrets. The First Minister, of course, heard from you directly. Teresa Whitfield also knows. We're going to put you on speaker.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Please, thank you. Thank you very much for not only being who you are, but also being an excellent Goodwill Ambassador for someone like me who really wanted to be there. And I really heard your words, and you were speaking on my behalf. Nicola, Teresa, Mark, Liz, all of you sitting there, I just want to say how much I personally regret not being with you. I was so much looking forward to it. But you know, the situation, the circumstances are really quite special. And I know when you talk about Syria, it's always special. But when you look at it now, I mean, we're having Aleppo, which is literally burning. We have 300,000 people in one side of Aleppo, which is eastern Aleppo, which is almost de facto besieged. And then you have 1.6 million people who are still people in Aleppo, who are in the government control area, but they're receiving a lot of mortar shelling and bad things happening to them, including lack of water and electricity on both sides. Then you have Daraya, one of the symbols, and Liz, you know how much it was a symbol of the beginning of the insurgency, which now has ended de facto its existence, and we are involved in facilitating whatever can be done in order to make sure that what we did not agree upon, because we were not part of the evacuation of Daraya, is done at least in the most human and possibly according to humanitarian law. And then you have, at the same time, Russia and America were seriously, let's be frank, seriously talking for hours and hours in Geneva. They did not come up with yet a conclusion, but they did not give up. And we are working with them in order to make sure that those details, quote unquote, which are still pending, and they are important details, can be solved in order to have some form of agreed cessation of hostilities. I cannot go more in details on that. And at the same time, people are there in Aleppo and elsewhere, but particularly now in Aleppo. And we are trying to have convoys of humanitarian aid reaching both sides through the most safe road, while knowing that our colleagues, while ready to do it, are not committing suicide. In other words, having at least an agreed pause by all sides in order to allow humanitarian aid to reach both sides of Aleppo. And that is not taken, because you know what? Even in this very moment, we are having a militarization of the conflict, and you can see it, all the news are military mode, and then you have a politicization of the humanitarian aid. In other words, you cannot go there. Unless you go there, you can't distribute unless you use this road or that road. Instead of thinking people are in need, UN, whatever you can do, do it, and do it, by the way, in the road that you prefer to. All this is happening while I'm talking. So I hope you will appreciate and forgive me for not being with you, but it's really all happening at the same time. And all of that is connected and connectable. Over to you.
And Staffan, we won't keep you very long, but thank you very much for giving us our own briefing on the really terrible situation in Syria, but we hope a situation which is not completely without hope. We would just, before we let you go, could you just share with us your thoughts? You, when you took over as Syria envoy for the United Nations, described as the toughest job in the world, one of the first things you did was to set up the first ever women's advisory panel to a peace process, or at least a process to trying to get a peace process. You've now had it for more than a year. Can you tell us what you believe the value of that advisory panel has been?
Absolutely. And first of all, let me say now that since Nicola is there, really how much I thank her And frankly, Marco has been supporting us on this in order to make all what they've been doing in order to support this women's advisory. Well, the advisory board is a response by us to those in the government and in opposition that shows up with 3 women out of 15 delegates, and they don't even allow them to talk. So what we have decided to do, well, we will have our own delegation of women, Syrian women, and give them all the time they want to talk, not only but to express their opinion, and put it into the head and into the papers of the special envoy, who will be then including that into his own mediation. And I must say also what you've been doing with the fellowships, and the fact that, Nicola, you have been now very much giving an example. Look at Scotland. Look at yourself. Look at the role that women in politics have been able to do, both in the government and in opposition. Well, we are using that as an example to make sure that Syrian women feel that we are not just going through an academic process here. We are helping them to prepare themselves to fight politically, not militarily, for the future of Syria. Bottom line, I find this a very useful and, frankly, very constructive approach, because I've been able to find plenty of new ideas thanks to them, not thanks to delegations who come and just say, I don't want to talk to you or to the other one. Over to you.
Finally, Staffan, I'm going to put you on the spot. What do you think? It's one thing to have an advisory panel. What is really needed is for women to be the decision makers, to be at the top table. What would you aspire to in terms of, I know it's a horrible thing, percentages, that the delegation should be 25% women, 40% women? How much should it be?
Well, first of all, we are trying through exactly the fellowship and through the training to make sure that even if the women were only 20% or 25%, their caliber, their quality of involvement and their strength will be like 80%. But that's a matter of quality, not of quantity. Having said that, the number is 30% at least, and we are insisting on that.
Now we know why you're such a good Swedish-Italian diplomat. Thank you very much, Stefan. We'll look for good news. Thank you. First Minister, I want to ask you, it's become like motherhood and apple pie. It's a good thing to have women at the table. But tell us, convince us, why is it you are a woman at the table? What difference do you think you bring by virtue of being a woman? You always have your own personal characteristics, but does gender bring anything?
Well, yes, it does. But first of all, let's not gloss over the fact that it is the right thing to have women fully involved around any decision-making table anywhere, regardless of what it's talking about. Women, in this country, we're not a minority. We are just slightly a majority of the population. So any process that doesn't hear the voices of women in a very meaningful way is a process that isn't representative of the society we live in. So it is the right thing to do. And I think while we shouldn't end there, we shouldn't simply gloss over that fact. But I do think, in addition to that, women do bring a different perspective. I should say here, I'm always a little bit nervous about overgeneralizing or stereotyping. You get good women leaders and bad women leaders, just as you get good and bad male leaders. Women are individuals. We're not a homogenous group. We bring, as individuals, different skills and talents and attributes and different weaknesses and faults and foibles as well. But I think, if I can immediately contradict myself and generalize, women, I think, if we are generalizing, I think do bring a different perspective. In my experience, women are more likely than men to put themselves in the shoes of the person sitting on the other side of the table, more likely than men to not have ego get in the way of finding a solution, more likely sometimes than men to be prepared to reach out. So I think there's an openness and an empathy and an understanding that women often bring to a discussion that some men, and we shouldn't generalise about men any more than we generalise about women, do. But most importantly, I think if we have women and men equally represented around the table, then we get the best mix of perspectives and experiences and skills and talents, and that's got to be a good thing.
Do you think you get treated differently because you're a woman?
Oh, absolutely, yes. Women in politics get treated very, very differently to men. I don't think there's any doubt about that. I'm not sure there's many male politicians who, almost without exception, every single day can pick up a newspaper somewhere and read a very detailed commentary on what they wear and what their hair looks like and how they look. So, you know, women, one of the things that I often reflect on is that many things, and I think this is particularly true of politics, but will have applicability in other areas as well, things that in a man will be seen as an attribute and a strength. You know, a man is assertive and shows leadership. A woman is bossy and strident. So things that in a man are seen as real character strengths, in a woman are often seen as weaknesses or things that are not particularly attractive. So there's a very different way of viewing and reporting on women. My view is that will be over time dealt with when we get to the point where women in leadership positions are just the norm and not the exception, and it's something that's taken for granted.
There are challenges, hurdles, and joys to being a woman in politics in Scotland, in any, that is, for the lack of a better word, developed Western society. Spare a thought if you're a woman trying to be involved in politics in the countries that your first 13, 25 fellows come from Syria, from Libya, from Yemen, from Lebanon, where not only you're facing a challenge as a woman, your country is on the brink. It's being torn apart. You met earlier this year the advisory council that Staffan de Mistura has set up. Could you share some of your thoughts? What did you learn from them about the challenges of getting women to the table and how you could help them?
Well, we hosted in Edinburgh a summit where members of Staffan's advisory council came to Edinburgh to, you know, in a safe, neutral space, talk through some of the challenges that they're facing. For me, it was a very interesting and actually quite a humbling experience. I met the women at the start of the, I think it was a four-day summit, and I met them again at the end. And the difference in these women from start to finish was really quite something to behold. At the start, there was a lot of tension and almost distrust in the room, a kind of fear of speaking out in front of each other. By the end of the session, there were women that clearly bonded, and it was the bonds and the friendships and the understandings that had developed that was very, very obvious. So I guess the first thing I learned was the importance of providing that space and helping. And I think Scotland's got a big role to play here, providing safe, neutral space for people in different sides of conflict to come and start to develop an understanding. Scotland, and I'm not going to overstate this, but I think Scotland, particularly for women in the prevention and resolution of conflict, we've got experiences of our own to offer. Now, in Scotland, it's not just that we have a woman First Minister. All of our main political parties are led by women. Doesn't mean we've not still got a long way to go, but I think that's an example that we can use and share. We've also got experience of dealing with a really difficult and at times vexed constitutional issue that inspires great passions on both sides in a peaceful and democratic way. Our independence referendum a couple of years ago in many countries and many parts of the world would have led to conflict and bloodshed. We dealt with that, not at times without falling out or shouting at each other, but entirely peacefully. Now that as well is something that I think we've got to offer. So I'm, you know, Scotland's a small country, but I think we have a role to play in trying to help others in other parts of the world find peace, and I'm keen that we find the ways in which we can play that role. And I've identified the role of women in conflict resolution as one area where I think we can offer something quite concrete.
Well, we're going to get more questions from you in the audience to the First Minister, but I'd like to bring in you now, Teresa, because you have looked at the history and the experience where women have been involved or not been involved in peacemaking, politics more generally. What does that experience tell us about what women have brought to the table?
Well, there's increasing sort of academic and empirical evidence of the role that the involvement of women in different ways makes to the sustainability of peace agreements, and I'm talking about armed conflict. And one of the challenges about involvement is that armed conflict tends to be resolved through negotiations amongst the armed groups, and often most of the leadership of men. So there have been different attempts to involve women, and there's kind of patchy progress at the elite level. If you look at the number of peace agreements made, there's still mainly, as Staffan has just explained, the first rank of the delegations are usually all men, though we've seen some good examples recently of processes where women have been centrally involved, and I think very effectively. If you look at the negotiations of the Philippine delegation, I attended some of the negotiations, and the Philippine delegation on the government side was led by women, and a lot of the representatives within it, I sat in on talks on security arrangements, and the Deputy Minister of Defense was leading the government side, was a woman. It encouraged the participation of women on the part of the Moro Islamic Front, which were the guerrillas opposite, and the negotiations went on a long time, and it was interesting, there was a little kind of banter amongst the delegations, and the amount of women on the government side encouraged the participation of women on the opposition side. You look at very different kind of negotiations. You look at the Iran nuclear negotiations, which was at a very kind of state-level negotiations, and I think something that would be well worth studying is the role that women played on the EU international side, very strong women, something you covered extensively, Lyse. Recent example, I think another way of doing it, we've just had the very positive news for those of us who work on conflict resolution at a very depressing time with the terrible problems that the world is facing. We look at the good news that came out of Colombia this week. Colombia is a horrible conflict, been going on for 50 years with terrible levels of suffering and huge amounts of internal displacement as well as people killed within the country. Very four-year, very difficult process of negotiations in Havana, which I, in a previous existence, attended a bit. Was a subcommission on women, a gender subcommission, which had a mandate within the negotiations to review all the agreements and put in language and adapt language to make sure that they're inclusive. There was also a very strong role of women of different kinds attending the talks, both amongst there was a process that the UN facilitated of victims coming and putting their stories before the talks. Very difficult because it obviously involved people with different experiences from different sides of the conflict, so even selecting the people who came was very difficult. Women played a strong role there. Women leaders in civil society, I think sometimes on the conflict end, the conversation can get overly focused on women as victims and women and children as victims of either of displacements or refugees or violence, divorce, at times gender-based violence as well. But there are a variety of very good examples of women as strong agents and leaders for peace, both as peace building and as civil society organizations. So there's all sorts of ways, and it goes back to the first utterly basic point that the First Minister made, is that just women are half the world's population, and both in a normative and just practical sense, if you want a peace agreement to be owned and sustained by a population, then women have to be involved. Mm.
But it's interesting, you know, to pick up when you began by mentioning how in the Philippines has had a number of different peace processes, that the women have played an active role there. Mm. But across Filipino society, women are involved. Mm-hmm. And so we can't look at women in politics and peacemaking separate from women playing roles across society. So in when societies then are developed in terms of women's health and education, mm-hmm. and engagement across the board, it makes it easier for them to then transfer that to these sorts of processes. So there's no one answer, is there, across the world?
No, because there's no one answer of involvement. I think those of us who work on the kind of mediation end, and the division I work with in the UN supports a lot of peace processes and provides experts to support processes. Mark is one of them, Marie-Joëlle, looking at over there, a number of colleagues, excellent colleagues we've worked with. One of the things we can do is make sure that as many of the experts we provide are women as possible. But then it's also very important that everybody who works with us now, there's a kind of gender, it's a horrible phrase, but gender mainstreaming, meaning that men as well and across the work of those involved in peace processes are thinking in sort of, it's a very, very basic thing, but just thinking at every stage of a conflict process, that what does this mean for the different populations affected? What does this mean for the women and children? And what does it mean through conflict prevention, or if you're doing security arrangements, you're doing disarmament, you're doing reintegration, what are the differences? Because there are differences in the way people experience conflict. And there are different ways, and I active mediators, as Staffan just explained, you find, and it happened, for example, in the Kofi Annan mediated talks on Kenya in 2008-2009, the delegations came forward. They didn't have women, but then there was a mechanism created to consult with women's organizations away from the main table, but make sure that their views were reflected into the sort of the top level tier of discussions. So there are all sorts of different ways to do it. The main thing is just to be thinking about it all the time.
Mm-hmm. Especially when these processes now are not just about putting down the guns. The guns are often held by the men, yeah. And not exclusively so, but these processes are also about health and education and reconciliation and resources, and these, you need more people asking different kinds of questions, and the only way to do that is to bring in people who have different perspectives, which is, do we have another phone here?
Not guilty.
yes. If you're expecting a call from Theresa May, please keep your phone on. If, however, you are not expecting a call from Theresa May, please turn off your phone. Thank you. Now, in the spirit of Beyond Borders, I decided to check across borders to see what people thought of our discussions here today. So I put out a question to say, what difference does it make getting women at the table? And one man, he doesn't say what he does, but he's a very good answer. He said, because women bring in novel perspectives and priorities. But that's a good answer. Another person who calls himself a mystic said that women are more peaceful than men. And I figure he's a mystic, he must know. But then a historian weighed in and said, Indira Gandhi, Bandara Naika, Golda Meir, Margaret Thatcher, do women make a difference? None, he said. That was the historian. And oh, yes, Angela Merkel, yes, there's a good one, yes. And finally, one woman said, first and foremost, it is a right of women to be at the table. But I think all of us here would agree, it's one thing to have a right, but it's another thing, we don't want tokenism, we want them to be there for a reason.
I saw you put that question out on Twitter this yes. morning. I thought it was a very brave thing to do. I'm sure you got some less polite replies as well, but I think that the perspective of the historian is quite interesting there, because all of the women he's listed, and you know, as of today, women in leadership positions are the exception rather than the norm. And individual women in individual positions, almost in that tokenistic way, are not going to make the lasting sustainable difference. It's when we have women involved at every level of society, at every level of government, and every level of our economy that we'll start to see that difference. And you know, I'm interested in how, over the longer term, we're talking about women in conflict resolution, women in conflict prevention is just, if not more important, longer term. And that perhaps comes when we get women just, you know, as a matter of course, involved in all of the decision making that often in parts of the world now leads to conflict, that perhaps that different perspective over time might lead to fewer conflicts. So I think it's unfair to take, you know, particular women and say, well, they haven't managed to sort of secure world peace single-handedly. it's about making sure that we use the experiences of individual women to make that the norm and, you know, mainstream it over time.
We have microphones here if you would like to ask questions, but I think I'm going to give the first question to the people who've come the furthest, and that is our fellows, the 1325 fellows. If one of you would like to, if you don't want to do the first one, I can give you some time to think, that to stand up and say, what do you think, why as a woman you want to be here and why you want to be at the table and what you can bring.
Okay. First, thank you for being here and giving us this chance. It's really amazing. But my
where did you come from?
My name is Lamia. I come from Libya.
Really?
And
welcome.
I sit on the women track the national dialogue that's taking place under the umbrella of UN for building peace in Libya. And I want to share a very short story. I would like your opinion on this. We had a meeting with the UN delegation, Mr. Cobbler, and he started his speech to us saying, "I just was with a meeting with the 9 men in the Presidential Council, and I feel very disappointed. They're all men." My reply to him when I got the mic was, "Well, we feel disappointed too, but we weren't the UN that brokered this agreement." And my question: what is the international legal commitment towards women in struggle area?
So you think it should be stated now that a negotiating team is in Libya, convened by the UN, must legally have women on at the table?
I said it very openly. I think that the UN did not meet its legal and moral obligation towards Libyan women. That's my take on it.
Do you think it should be put in law?
Yeah, I do think that's something that we have to face up to, because we can't leave it to women alone, and we can't expect progress to happen without the leadership of the United Nations and leadership across the board. So if we agree that having women involved in peace processes is the right thing to do, then somebody's got to take responsibility for making sure that peace negotiations and peace processes don't go ahead without women being involved around the table. And I think that's a really, really important point to make, and something that I think all of us have to be prepared to acknowledge.
Could you please tell Martin Kobler, when you go back to Libya, that this is what the First Minister of Scotland has told him?
But we have to, we also have to play our part in supporting women to be. That's why the fellowship programme here that we're supporting in Scotland, we're announcing today that we're funding Beyond Borders to train more women through the fellowship programme. And that's a small thing we can do, but it's our way of trying to support the capacity of women to take part. But, it's got to be at both ends. We've got to help women with the skills and the capacity they need to take part, but then there's got to be an absolute expectation on the part of the international community that they're at the table, and not in a tokenistic way, but in a meaningful way.
Hands, please. The gentleman here, the best seat in the house.
Well, thank you very much indeed for a fascinating presentation. Last week...
Where are you from?
I'm from Temple.
Oh.
The former People's Republic of Midlothian. I'm a councillor there as well. But last week, the Scottish government, or whoever it was, announced figures on the amount of money paid to women compared to men. And the figures were awful. I mean, particularly women that had given birth, had taken time off, and then went back into work, they were paid only 30% of what men were paid. And somehow, one needs to change that. And what kind of rules, regulations, legislation have you in mind, First Minister, to sort that problem? Because we talk all about equality, but the equality in payment is absolutely dreadful.
Very good point. Thank you. We vote you President of Temple.
That's, one of the most important questions domestically, Peter, is about the gender pay gap. I often, I'm about to give away my age here for those who don't already know my age, but the Equal Pay Act was passed in the year I was born, and I'm slightly older than 21, so, and yet all these years later, we still don't have equal pay in this country. And the figures you talk about, they were not Scottish Government figures, they were figures published for the picture across the UK, showing that there is still a significant gap between what men get paid and the pay of women. There's a whole variety of things we need to do to resolve that. I want us to lead by example in Scotland. We're slightly frustrated in what we can do here, because employment law is one of these issues that is reserved to the UK government. So one of the things I think we should do, and we are doing this in Scotland around public bodies where we do have the power, is have complete transparency that, public organisations and I think private companies should have to publish the information on their pay gap and what they're going to do to reduce that. We have to also have, you know, through a variety of different measures around, you know, progressive workplace practices, support for women coming back into the workplace after they've had breaks to have and raise children, for example. We have to make sure that that's not then holding women back and there is a gap opening up that's impossible to overcome. One of the things we're about to pilot in Scotland is this notion of returnships, which the United States have done successfully, to look at how women, when they're coming back into the workplace, are supported so that they are not coming back in with, you know, a massive lag in their earning potential or their career opportunities. So there's a huge range of things we need to do. But often, like many of these things, it's about the leadership. It's about people, not just women, but men too, because men are still in many of these decision-making roles. We've got to stand up and say the gender pay gap, underrepresentation of women in decision-making roles is no longer acceptable in modern Scotland or the modern UK or the modern world. And we have to make sure that we don't accept it as something that we just shrug our shoulders about.
Very good point. Okay, I want to get as much comments as possible. I'm going to take a few in succession. Back here. Okay, and then.
Hello, yes. I was a social worker in children and families, mainly in Scotland, but also in Canada and London and various other places. And I was a foster parent for criminal justice teenagers in Canada. And I have been out of social work a wee while, but I wondered what is happening with the education of young women. Especially in schools, there is a lack of teaching of relationships and the skills required for most young women who will become the mothers of the future in bringing up, rearing children. I noticed with the teenagers in criminal justice that if the mother was unstable, it had much more of an effect on both sexes, male and female, than it did if the father was unstable. So I'm wondering what support for single mothers, what support
for
relationships,
very good question,
especially in Scotland, first and foremost.
Thank you. We're just going to take another, just back here, to your right, to your, behind the hand, you can see, Turner.
Thank you. I was very struck by Lyse Doucet's remark quite early in this session when she said, use the words, not completely without hope. And I wondered if I could just ask you to comment on that. Thank you.
Okay. And just we'll take two more here in the front, of the, running up the microphone, and then, oh, and then we'll come back to you. Okay. Just two here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Quick question. How, on the international scene, do you deal with societies, religions, where there's bigotry and where women are regarded in a totally different way? What is the process for beginning, in a sense, to transform and translate equality as we understand it?
Okay, and just pass the microphone to behind you, and then we'll take a last round. Yep.
On the question of women being treated differently in politics, what is your opinion concerning the political trial, the so-called impeachment brought against Brazilian President Dilma Rousseff?
Okay, good. Do you want to first, Minister, start with the education?
Yeah, I mean, I've tried to remember all these questions.
Don't worry.
You've got them all. We do have good relationship education in our curriculum in Scotland. I think, you know, we always have to make sure that we ensure that that is appropriate to, you know, the world we live in and the various different aspects of relationships. But I think it's absolutely crucial. And crucial because you're right that all sorts of evidence will show that, you know, where a woman is unstable, that will have a bigger impact on families and children. But one of the key aspects, I think, of relationship education is to make fathers understand better their role in stable families and raising well-adjusted children of the future. So, you know, that is a key part of the focus we have in the curriculum on education about love and relationships and respect in relationships.
And what about, there was comments that Dilma Rousseff in her impeachment, that she was treated differently because she was a woman. And the same was said about the Argentine president. And people started to say, well, there's more and more women leaders in Latin America, but they're being treated differently than the men. Would you, do you have a view on that?
Yeah, I mean, that's a much more serious manifestation of what I was talking about earlier on. Women are treated differently. They are judged differently, treated by different criteria when we fail or are, you know, alleged often wrongly to have failed or done, you know, things wrongly, often the punishment and the treatment that is meted out to women is much tougher and less understanding. And, you know, I think that is a statement of fact. How do we deal with that? Partly that is about normalising women in leadership. It's not something that we're going to snap our fingers and deal with. It's about normalising women in leadership and through that, changing the attitudes of men and women towards women. Sometimes, and yeah, I'm going to be quite brave in going down this road, but sometimes as a woman, sometimes I find often my biggest critics and sometimes my what I would judge to be my unfairest critics are other women sometimes. So there's something there we've also got to face up to as well. Hmm.
Do you want to take on the question about, you know, values in society where there really are very harsh attitudes towards women?
It's yes, a difficult one. It's very different. I think from the perspective of those who are intervening to support conflict processes, and I think also of your reporting from Afghanistan and other places, I think there are two things. One is even in societies where culturally the role of women is very, very far from what we would consider normal in and acceptable and aspire to in some parts of the world, the work, I found that the work that women are able to do and the space that the women can occupy is extraordinary. I was in a meeting the other day with a delegation of women from Afghanistan, including an Afghan colonel and the woman colonel in the Afghan army. There are extraordinary processes and possibilities that and spaces that women are filling, even in, and I'm looking now at my colleagues and friends from the Middle East, even in countries which from the outside seem very repressive of the full enjoyment of women's rights. And I think we need to appreciate and nurture those spaces and recognize them, and not it's quite easy from the outside to think, oh, all women are repressed in country X. That's one thing. And another thing on the part of international actors, I think the power of demonstration and the putting women, making sure that, you know, there are professional women visible, a variety of women from a variety of countries. So whether it's the UN or other agencies, that there are fully professional women dealing in a normal way. And again, I think of the role that Lyse plays. Lyse is a top BBC correspondent. The whole world sees her all over the world interacting with powerful men, interacting with women. These kind of examples are, I mean, it's a small way, but there are things that you can do, and doing them right, it matters. But I would also be interested in what, something to discuss later with our colleagues from the Middle East over here.
I think we have a bit more time to ask questions, and I think it should come back to the women from the region. And on your question of not without hope, well, I think I will say, as a mediator will say, is that as long as there are people of goodwill and resources in mind, willing to work on a solution for Syria, for Libya, for Yemen, for all of the crises that we've mentioned here today, then you cannot lose hope. And I think we'll hear from you directly, but, you know, you can be on the point of hunger, you can lose your home, you can lose so much, but once you lose your dignity and your hope, then all is lost. So you have to try to hold on to those things to the very last. I think one of you had your hand up. Would you like to ask a question before we... Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much for Beyond Borders that have a chance to meet the First Minister. And thank you so much for Beyond Borders again for this program of fellowship. I'm a woman from Iraq, and I would like to bring your attention to our women. We are in conflict, all the women in Iraq. There is no program empowerment for our women. Especially, I am from Kirkuk. Mm-hmm. Kirkuk, we have 2,000 widows. We have women inside prison. We have sexual violence. Commonwealth supported us for 8 months. We got 300 cases of sexual violence. We have ISIS around us. We are in a war. So we need training center for police officers to train them on women's rights, how to deal with the women inside prison. Mm-hmm. There is many violence against women. We don't have shelter. We don't have any kind of training to make the women to be in as a woman decision makers.
to, there is no role of law for women inside Kirkuk, and I'm talking all about on whole women in Iraq. So just I wanted to bring your attention to our women in Kirkuk. We have many parties inside Kirkuk. They are just working for their power, not for the citizens. So women cannot take any decision. She don't have any right. So
thank you very much for sharing how the dire situation in Kirkuk, and Kirkuk is just a small snapshot of so many cities across Iraq, and Iraq isn't getting the attention it deserves. But in one sentence, if you could speak for you and your colleagues, what kind of assistance would women mediators need to be able to be more effective players at the table? What is it you're lacking now?
I would like to have a special program for Kirkuk. The cycle of to support our women need legal clinic to support her legally. She don't have any right, as she don't have any right in Kirkuk. So we need to support her as a legal clinic and shelters.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think we have time for one.
Actually, this is Esra from Turkey. After hearing that, you know, fundamental problems, actually, now my question come to me very meaningless, but still I want to ask, as a woman, I want to ask something which is not related with women issues, actually. When in the course of this fellowship program and during this festival here, I was always thinking about the concepts and the terminology that we're using. You know, in Turkey, and I'm sure that in different parts of the conflict, you know, zones, actually human rights, women rights, children rights, by itself increasingly become, you know, a tool for the conflicting parties, which they use against each other. They trigger, you know, each other among these concepts. So, for example, they just try to make the women to be victims after an attempt of, I don't know, attack from one side. So, I mean, is there any kind of measurements of any kind of mechanisms of prevention for the conflicting parties to abuse these concepts?
It's a very good, very important point. I want to also give a chance for someone from Scotland, from another side of the world to ask a question. Yes, this lady.
To what extent are the current conflicts driven by the arms trade? Mm-hmm. And if they are, what can we all do to decouple ourselves from the arms trade?
Okay, good. First, do you want to ask, we had comments about the people of Kirkuk and the women of Kirkuk.
Firstly, thank you for being here with us. Thank you for sharing your experiences. I think listening to both of those contributions, what it brings home very forcibly is that this is not just a discussion about getting women around the tables where the big discussions are had. This is about the living conditions and the treatment of women on the ground in countries all over some of these regions. So it's about the human rights of women at a very, very practical level. And that is about, you know, equipping women, challenging, you know, there was a question that we didn't get to earlier on about how do we challenge the treatment of women within religions and faiths. And we've got to recognise human rights are universal, they are indivisible, and, you know, we need to take it from that perspective. But I think we're having a discussion here that's very much, and rightly so, at the macro level, but it's about, you know, the conditions women are living in. This time last week I was in Srebrenica talking to the mothers of the genocide victims in Srebrenica, and that, you know, discussion was very similar in terms of the practical realities of how women are treated. So I think you've brought home just how big a challenge we've got, but how important it is that at all of these levels we're trying to support and to challenge and to make things better on the ground as well as in the big peace discussions that we've been talking about.
Teresa, you've seen how language is so important and how concepts can be emptied and used by one side or the other in bigger battles. Do you have any advice for our fellows?
I think I just reiterate the core point on a rights-based approach. It's really difficult in when it's picked up, and we've seen in a variety of different conflicts where one side armed group is a terrorist and the other, and it gets bandied about, and the victims of that is the civilian population, and the victims of that are rights. So framing the issue of women's participation within that broader discussion is really important, but it's really, really hard at the rock face, and it's kind of, you feel kind of humbled sitting up here, because it's kind of easy to talk about, and it's easy to talk about what you can try to do, and yet for those of you who are in the middle of this and living this in the situation described in Kirkuk, it feels kind of poor solace, except that it's important that people know and appreciate and understand, and there are probably people here who might not be familiar with where Kirkuk is, and they will look it up and they will learn more, and that's helpful. So again, I think it's really great that you're here, and I really commend the First Minister in Scotland for supporting the work that's able to back this fellowship, and I look forward to seeing how it goes forward.
Mm. And First Minister, does the arms trade get in the way? Does it block peace?
Undoubtedly, I think that is... My answer to that in a very simple way would have to be yes. I think that's the case. I think it's also important not to oversimplify some of the discussions about these conflicts, because there are many different factors and drivers at play here. But, you know, I think my view is that we perhaps don't talk enough about some of the, you know, very hard... headed economic drivers, the arms trade being one of them, that are a factor in many conflicts around the world. Mm.
First Minister Sturgeon, you are a woman leader, but you're also a democratically elected politician. So I'm going to take this nice sample, a voter sample in this tent, to put a question to all of you. With a show of hands, how many of you really appreciate that Scotland is getting involved in its own way in helping to develop peacemaking tools and helping to develop women to be part of peacemaking, and would like Scotland to do more of that? I think that was a... Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. First Minister, thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to share your reflections on being a woman politician and your commitment to peacemaking and to working with women who are peacemakers and will play a role in various roles in their country. Teresa, with your long experience, thank you very much for sharing them. Thank you to all of you for being with us here in this tent. We started under a dark cloud and you brought the sun out, so that's a good sign. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Louise, for that funding pitch, which we've recorded, and the check will be in the post. If you could just stay here for 3 or 4 minutes, we have one last element of this session. I want to introduce Mariela Shaker, who started playing the violin when she was 10 years old from Aleppo, joining the Arab Institute of Music in Aleppo. She has performed at many concerts across Syria, but also for President Obama at the White House. And she has been selected as a champion of change for world refugees. And both her brother and mother and father are still in Aleppo. So I'm going to ask her to come onto the stage. We've got a monitor that needs... No. We've got a monitor that's coming in. Just one minute. So I'll ask her to come up onto the stage in a couple of minutes' time. Can I just simply say, in relation to Kirkuk, just so that you all know about this, that Beyond Borders, of course, is not just an organisation that puts on festivals and cultural exchange. We actually are funding mobile human rights units in Kirkuk with the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and we are recording all the data of sexual violence cases to try and build up a more comprehensive picture. And we are doing many other projects across the MENA region as well, linked to women's rights. So if anyone feels like not just putting their hands up, but putting their hands in their pockets, we would be extremely grateful. But thank you very, very much. And Mariela, can I ask you perhaps to come to the stage and play?
Thank you so much. It gives me a great pleasure and honor to be here with you today. Thank you so much, Beyond Borders, for the wonderful Fellowship Peace Program and for having me. I was one of these young people in Syria whom their dreams were eventually vanished and demolished in the war. Life in Syria is truly impossible, and there is nothing worse than experiencing death every minute there. I was able to flee my torn city of Aleppo based on a music scholarship I received in the United States. Unable to return back home, I was granted asylum, and I recently received my green card. I feel grateful I'm in the United States, and I feel safe there, but I'm constantly deeply concerned about my family and friends in Syria who are still struggling and surviving with the basic necessities of life, running with no water, electricity, or safety. I feel powerless to change the current tragedy ongoing in my country. However, I believe so much in the power of music, and I believe in its ability to fashion peace and love in our world. Music is a very powerful language, and it can remove the barriers and reunite us together. And I can prove this when I'm Christian myself, and when I'm going to perform now Jewish music for Arab community. Thank you so much.